All right, shall we get started? I'd like to welcome everybody to September 20th, 2016 meeting of Northampton Transportation and Parking Commission. I'll note the audio and video recording of the meeting. And let's begin first with just some introductions for the benefit of the public. I'm Ryan O'Donnell, I'm the chair of the commission, and we'll go around and start with our question.
I'm Gina Louise Sharon, the ward clerk, councilor, and vice chair.
Judy Casper, chief of police.
Nancy Forrestal, assistant city collector.
Ann Brooks, planning board.
Kristen Burnett, citizen.
Donna Muscaglia, director of public works.
Dave Pomerantz, director of essential services.
Richard Cooper, citizen.
Jamie Fisher, citizen.
Terry, GPW clerk.
Okay. And we'll begin, as we always do, the period of public comments, an opportunity for members of the public to speak on any issue you may wish. If the thing you're here for appears later on the agenda, feel free to wait for that item, because you guys will be able to speak at that point as well. Or you can speak twice. Is there anyone who'd like to speak on any subject? Let's, please. Sure. And if you would give your name and address. Would you prefer to?
You want to put that on the chair?
No, just make it. My name is Jill Phelps. I live at 533 Audubon Road in Leeds. This may take me a little minute here to get through this. I have a handout for all of you, and I've been drawing pictures of maps of the area in question. I'm just going to read this to try to get through it. As I said, my name is Bill Phelps. I'm a Leeds resident, retired RN. I have two children at the Northampton High School. I find the location of the handicapped parking at the high school very inaccessible. I have struggled with it for years, as it is often used for middle school, after school performances. Although I have been told technically they are up to code, they are certainly not very accessible for someone with a mobility issue. The issue here is that the spaces allotted are too far and downhill from the main entrance. I estimate the distance using the Google Maps. The spaces to the sidewalk, around the loop, up the incline, to the main door, about 400 feet. The distance and the incline is way too difficult for many. There is another parent whose child also is a student who uses a wheelchair, and they have also expressed some difficulty to the office staff. Also, there's many handicapped students who would also benefit from the improvements I'm going to suggest. I have met with Brian Lombardi, the principal of NHS, and have his full support. He would also like to see the handicap and visitor spaces moved closer also. He told me that he had ordered a buzzer security system for the lower door by the spaces. This would bring you closer to the elevator, but however, it doesn't help as the distance is still too far, walking inside the school instead of outside. The handicapped spaces should be close to the main entrance. The closest spaces at present, closest parking spaces at present, are in the loop. I believe they are labeled as visitor parking. They are frequently taken, and the city of Northampton maintenance van is parked there daily. If I remember correctly, there used to be handicapped parking there. In fact, I believe there is still evidence on the pavement where it was painted over. If one was finally able to make it up to the upper level, there is a ramp to doors that lead you to the hallway to the office. Outside, there are two huge circular steps in front of the main door, another obstacle. There is a sidewalk next to the steps. You don't necessarily have to take the steps, but don't think steps should be in front of a place like that. I am asking the City of Northampton to improve the location of the handicap parking spaces to allow equal access to all persons in need of visiting the high school. The city has contracted Alta Planning and Design to conduct the baseline of city sidewalks, ramps, and curbs. This area of concern should be considered in their report. Many years ago, I don't know exactly when, maybe 7 to 10 years, for some reason the city decided to detour the street in front of the school. This portion of Elm Street was closed off, filled in, and rerouted. Bike racks added. As I have had a few meetings at the school, I've had to park in a no parking area near this detour. While walking along the sidewalk at that section, I've noticed a very unkept area by the curbing in front of the school. The area is all washed out, a great area for someone to break their ankle. Where this is washed out, I see evidence of an old asphalt road. Another visit when I was looking at this building space, I noticed curbing still present on the other side of the road. Was loam simply applied to the road and grass planted? This area could be easily reopened for handicapped and visitor parking. Mr. Lombardi would like it also used for bus drop-off. This would aid in lessening congestion during school drop-off and pickup times. The intersection of, I'm not sure I have the street right, it's a little confusing, intersection of Elm and Elm Street is a very dangerous situation. I was very surprised when I first brought my daughters to school there that there wasn't a police officer directing traffic. Moving the buses to the front of the school and allow limited traffic by the front of the school would help alleviate some of the congestion by the crosswalk and intersection. Personally, I would also like to see the road open in front of the school for safety reasons. Should there be a fire at the school, I would think fire trucks would have better access to the front of the school if need be. Another area that could be assigned handicapped parking would be the spaces on Elm Street along the little park, which used to be an island before the road was filled in. I believe there are 8 spaces there possibly now with limited parking signs. There's a sidewalk through the park to the front of the school. Signage could be changed and a ramp made if needed for wheelchair access. The last area I propose that could be used for handicapped parking is in front of the school where the road has been detoured, where the signs are. A few spaces could be made straight in from the detour, no parking signs. This would make an area level to the main area of the school and closest to the front entrance. I have contacted the Massachusetts Office of Disability regarding this matter, and they've been very helpful and will continue their support. The Americans with Disability Act law came in 1990. The civil rights law prohibits discrimination against individuals with disabilities in all areas of public life, including jobs, schools, transportation, and all public and private places that are open to the general public. The purpose of this law is to make sure that people with disabilities have the same rights and opportunities as everyone else. I have contacted many of my fellow 1974 classmates, and they have also asked to help with the situation. I have included a couple of letters that I have given letters of support from them and Administrative Assistant Julie Clark. I have the support of many of the clerical staff at the high school who see the need for the change daily, some of who were a part of a petition years ago to keep the road open for handicapped parking. This is a case where maybe just having something just up to code may not be enough. Do the right thing, Northampton, improve the handicapped parking situation at the high school. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Thompson. So I think it's helpful to hear that and hear your suggestions for members of the commission to get a sense And then you and I have exchanged emails and we can follow up after the meeting.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Is there anyone else who'd like to provide public comment? Anyone who walked in, if you were waiting to talk about something that's on the agenda, you can certainly wait until that time. But this is a time for general public comment on any other issue. So certainly the floor is open if anyone wants to avail themselves. Okay, well, we'll launch into our formal agenda. And we will start with item four, which is approval of minutes from two previous meetings. We have June 21st and August 16th, 2016. Is there a motion to approve both these, perhaps as a group? Okay, it's made and seconded. Any amendments or discussion on these items? A small, I think, Scribner's error on the second page of the August meeting. Simply the motion to nominate Councillor Shara to be vice chair. It was made and seconded, but of course there was no vote on the actual nomination until later. So it's okay with the committee. The commission will strike that vote at the very bottom of page two. It's kind of a typo. Anything else? Any other discussion? Okay, all in favor of these 2 minutes? Say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Okay, thank you very much. I'd like to take some of these out of order. There's a number of people who have come here today, and we want to accommodate our visitors, and I try to balance the number of people who have come here for an issue with how long I'm guessing each item will take. So I'll do my best to balance those two things and respect everyone's time. I would like to start with item eight, which are three ordinances related to parking fees and time limits and so forth. And I'll just read them. I'll read the titles right now so to get us started. Item 8A is 16.1164, an ordinance to amend Chapter 312.36 of the Code Book, Parking Meter Locations and Regulations, to modify the time limits and fees of Class 1A and Class 1C parking zones and to add a new class. Also in this item is 16.165, an ordinance to amend Chapter 312.109 of the Code Book, that's Schedule 8, on-street parking meter zones, and that's to modify the parking time limits and or parking zone classes for certain portions of streets, including Main Street, Downtown, Merritt Lane, Crafts Avenue, and Bridge Street. And finally, 16.166, an ordinance to amend Chapter 312.110 of the Code Book, that's Schedule 9, off-street parking areas, to modify the parking limit in the Cinconifley lot, a number of spaces in front of the Maplewood shops. So that's a mouthful, but I think the best way to start this conversation is to recognize the mayor. He has proposed his ordinances, and so if we can do that, and Mr. Mayor, if you would present them to us.
Thank you. Thanks. It's great to be part of the TPC. So I think there was an email or a memo that I sent to council that you may have gotten with your packet, but some of you may know that in 2015 we had a comprehensive parking management study prepared for us by Walker Consulting. They made a number of recommendations, both short, intermediate, and long term, about our parking system. As I pointed out in the memo to City Council, this is the first of several attempts to begin implementing those recommendations. This is the first that require ordinances. And specifically, we're focused on Main Street and the two recommendations of the report that we implement, go from 1 hour to 2 hour parking on Main Street, as well as adjusting the pricing of the industry to differentiate it from all of our other on-street and off-street parking throughout Main Street. If I know you have the study in front of you, or at least a binder has been provided to you with that. You know, one of the things that the report points out, I don't have the right excerpt that I thought I had in front of me, but as you read through it, you'll note that they did a lot of, the study involved not only looking at our data, they also sent out folks to take a look at actual parking habits on Main Street, and they looked at occupancy rates throughout all of our city and the downtown, throughout all of downtown. And really, they found that there was a difficulty in terms of occupancy on Main Street in particular. There was a lack of turnover, difficult to find parking spaces. And they kind of point out quite poignantly in the report that, you know, people that are driving around cruising for parking on Main Street, parking is priced the same on Main Street as it is, for example, in the Armory Street lot, where there was plenty of parking during that same time that there was no parking on Main Street. So pretty much all of our other on-street parking, outside of Main Street is 75 cents, as is the current parking on Main Street. And then as you slowly move away from, further and further from Main Street, it begins to get less expensive, and more time available if you're willing to walk a little bit farther. The garage, of course, right in the heart of downtown, still remains a great bargain, and I think that was one of the other things mentioned in the study, that this might encourage people to try to utilize the garage more. With the first hour free, you can park for 2 hours for 50 cents. So the proposal I put forward now, and the reason initially when I came before another committee of the council, I indicated that I was hoping to put all of these forward together as a package. We are holding off on some of the other ordinance changes until we get the technology upgrades in place. Those won't actually be, we won't be able to get those deployed until after the holiday season, but we really felt it was important to get the 2 hour parking in particular deployed before the holiday season, because that's something that we've heard so much from merchants, that that having that additional hour on Main Street would be valuable. So when you look through, there's three ordinances. The only other change that's happening in these ordinances, we're trying to basically, anywhere that we have currently 1 hour parking downtown, we're trying to make sure that that is increased 2 hours and put in the proper class. You'll note that the Maplewood Shops is also included in this. There's a row of 21 spaces that face the shops on Maplewood right now. Those are currently 1 hour, and we actually had a meeting with the owners of that property. They were supportive of going to 2 hour. Oddly, you'll note that we are making a correction because the fee currently shows 15 cents an hour. We believe that was an error that had just sort of been carried over, hadn't been changed in the code book, because obviously we're charging 25 cents an hour in the Maplewood lot. So we're also making that correction. So that's the only other kind of outlier are those Maplewood spaces, which are also 1 hour spaces. And again, same situation. There are lots of service businesses. There's hair salons, et cetera. And an hour is not sufficient. So that's what the recommendation is. Again, it aligns with the recommendation of the traffic consultant, and I have submitted this to City Council and would appreciate a positive recommendation from the TPC.
Okay, thank you very much.
And I can answer any questions.
Yeah, are there questions or comments? Commission? Yes.
So just to clarify, there'll be no more 1 hour parking left downtown.
Well, there is still, there's actually, Forbes Library has some 1 hour spaces along the side of their building. You may know that we have parking there. There's also one lone kind of outlier space in the Roundhouse lot. That's a 1 hour space that was set up, I believe, probably for taxis or something like that. We are also holding off on that one because we're kind of taking a comprehensive look at the Roundhouse lot as part of the phase two of the Pulaski Park construction. So we're going to save that one until we come forward with the next round. So those would be the only other 1 hour metered or time spaces that would be left. And again, the Forbes one is a unique situation. It's along the side for like quick drop off and things like that.
You don't have a recommendation for this now, but since we're moving most of the parking to 2 hours, would you think that maybe more 15-minute spots would be helpful, since now, we have less shorter time limit spots?
So you're saying add more or take away?
Well, convert more of the, which would now be 2-hour spots to 15-minute spots.
Interesting. I think we have to look at that. I think, I mean, we've tried to place them selectively and in some cases move them to be around certain businesses where there's, you know, Main Street Cleaners was a good example. They moved, we moved one of the 15-minute spots to be in front of them. Some of the coffee places as well, or just quick in, quick out kind of places. So we have to take a look at that and inventory where they are and whether we should be adding more. Obviously, it's 15 minutes, so that means less opportunities for people to park on Main Street for longer than 15 minutes. So I think we have to be mindful of that as well. Because I know we've been rejiggering some parking spaces and taking out some parking spaces for buses, and so, but that's definitely something we should take a look at. Yeah.
Other questions?
Is the point, the 2-hour, to move it to 2 hours is obviously not to help turnover on Main Street. It's allow people to shop longer or eat longer.
Exactly. Okay. Yeah, it was mainly the, and this came out when the consultant did the public meetings to solicit input from parking. That was something that came through strong from business owners, that the 1 hour, which had been put in place, I think, to try to limit, you know, long-term parking, had really gone a little too far, and that the 1 hour just wasn't really sufficient if you were going to try to make multiple stops. The other thing that will be coming forward in the next round, it's one of the other recommendations, is moving the Masonic, and sometimes it's called the Armory Street lot. I think in the book it's called the Kirkland Avenue lot, but moving those to 3 hours. So you'll see we're actually creating a 3-hour off-street class as part of this ordinance, and the goal is to move Armory and Masonic to be 3 hours. Again, to try to provide options. So Main Street, 2 hours, and then if you move, you know, just behind Main Street, you have the option to park for less money for 3 hours. And then you can move into more of the 10-hour lots, the longer term lots. So those are some of the other recommendations that will be coming forward. But no other increases, contrary to clickbait headlines on newspapers to the south of us. It's really just this rate on Main Street that's changing. No other rate changes.
Got it. Okay.
And I think it's important to note for the public, and correct me if I'm wrong, but the idea of raising the rates is not to generate income for the city, it's to modify behavior of the parker.
It is, and it's a recognition that people, you know, make economic choices for parking, and that if, you know, one of the ways to incentivize people to park in the garage or to park further, that pricing is really important. Many cities are going to, you know, real-time pricing, surge pricing, you know, where they're looking at real-time, you know, more parking that's more in demand, the price goes up, and there's discounted pricing in places where there's ample parking. I don't think we're not big enough to be doing that, but it's a recognition that you know, and also, you know, that's prime real estate on Main Street, it's prime parking, and we're trying to, again, the cruising thing cannot be understated. People that will just drive around and around and around, you know, that adds to congestion and compromises safety. So that's it's really not a revenue issue. It's really about trying to price the parking adequately. Yeah.
Any other questions or thoughts? On the point Mr. Cooper raises, that this is not about revenue, it's about, and you, Meg, too, it's about influencing behavior. I think the study says in an ideal world we have 85% occupancy or something about that.
Yeah.
On Main Street. And I guess the question is, the assumption would be a quarter doesn't necessarily make that happen magically. And in fact, the study recommends higher rates over time, which you are not pursuing.
Yeah.
So I guess it's just kind of a question of how much money influences how much behavior. Mm-hmm. And so I imagine the city will be, after this change, monitoring
totally. Yeah.
The effect of the fee increase to see what effect it has.
Mm-hmm.
So that's part of your plan.
Most definitely. We'll be looking, you know, we'll be monitoring revenue and you know, the new system that we're eventually, the upgrades that we're going to be making to our kiosk system will allow better communication among all of the kiosks, so we'll be able to really be able to see if there's been a shift in where people are parking. And obviously the garage, you know, we've seen garage vacancy has increased with some of the changes we've made. This would be another thing to look at. Would this influence people's behavior? I mean, again, you can be on Main Street, you know, very quickly for less money. And there's no danger of getting a ticket in the parking garage. There's no ticketing there. So yeah, it's we'll be constantly reassessing this to see if it makes a difference. We'll go from there.
Have you looked at all at the cost of implementing this? So, I mean, just programming of the kiosk, but there is some signage that needs to be changed.
Yeah, initially we're going to just do some quick signage changes because it's going to be for the holidays. The main thing we have right now are the hanging signs that say 1 hour. We'll probably just do something temporarily over that. And then there is a cost of doing a programming of each of the kiosks. That's the other reason why we didn't want to do every kiosk in the city and implement all the other changes. But we feel that the benefit for doing it and moving to the 2 hour will more than, more than is worth it, particularly with bag day and the holiday season coming, so.
And are there maps on the website indicating parking that we need to adjust at all?
Yeah, those are graphical maps. We can make those changes. And re-update those to the city website if the ordinance passes.
And another important point is right after this meeting is meeting about signage. Which is important if you want to shift people from high demand areas to off street, lots of parking. That's happening in parallel.
Yep, and that's one of the other short term recommendations was for the city to retain a wayfinding consultant to help us do that. So there is going to be a public meeting at 6 right here to discuss that.
Any other comments from the commission? I just have one, you know, general question and comment, and that people will ask, you know, to what degree businesses have been brought into the process. And I know right off the bat that during the report phase, the information gathering phase, there were two public forums.
Yeah.
That happened even before these recommendations came down.
Yeah.
I'd also know it's anecdotal, but I can say at least one Main Street business owner has said to me that the increase in the 1 to 2 hour time limit is something they see is going to be beneficial to their business. But I don't know if you have anything further to add about
that. Well, I can tell you that I have. When the final recommendations were issued, we had another sort of public forum did have some input then at the time, and also I've done a lot of one-to-one walking around talking to different Main Street merchants. I've also met with and spoken with the chamber leadership as well as the DNA to talk about it, and that's really what I hear is the 2 hour. I mean, the thing for me, I think that most people won't, you know, there's a concern that are we pricing ourselves out, or is this going to like make people choose to go to, you know, the mall or choose to go somewhere else. I think more what affects people is the inability to find a parking space. If you're trying to get whatever it is, burrito or something, and you drive, or, you know, you're making laps and you can't find a space, that's probably more the reason why you're going to go somewhere else. Not that you're going to get there, get to the meter and say, oh, this is highway robbery,
right,
I'm leaving.
Too much.
So it tends to be more the availability of parking. Obviously, pricing is still, you know, we have to consider that. The only other thing I would mention is that the only other recommendation that you don't have before you is the consultant made a third recommendation, which was to also change the time on Main Street. Was to move Main Street until 8 p.m., to extend enforcement until 8 p.m. That was one that I did hear a lot of feedback on, and I personally felt that would be, if we were just going to make a change there and not system-wide, that it would be really confusing. It would be confusing for customers from one night to the next if they parked on State Street and parking was free after 6, and then suddenly they got a ticket on Main Street. That would be confusing. And so I think that's would be part of, I understand the policy rationale, but I think that has to be a longer conversation. But first, I want to sort of see how these changes affect us, and then we'll go from there.
Okay. We want to respect your time. Any other questions from the commission? I'd accept the motion. I think it would be appropriate to do this, to make a motion on all three as a group for recommendation, one way or the other. Okay. Made seconded. Any discussion on the motion to make a positive recommendation on these three ordinances? Okay, if not, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. Thank you, members of the commission.
And for anyone interested, this is going to other committees, one committee at least, Committee on Legislative Matters, which will meet Wednesday, October 12th. Here at 5 o'clock. The discussion will continue, and eventually these will come to the City Council. Okay. There are two of my colleagues here from the City Council who have come with issues from their constituents, and we have a number of people who I believe are here to speak on North Farms Road. So I'm going to prioritize the people over the politicians, I'm sorry, and move up North Farms Road, even though you're doing the public's work. So I'd like to jump right to item 7. 7A, this is a traffic calming application for North Farms Road, which was received on March 21st, 2016. I'll briefly explain our process for traffic calming. Citizens often ask for us to address perceived problems in speeding and traffic, and we have a process that we follow. The process is an application is put forward with signatures from the neighborhood. We take it up here in this commission as we're doing today, and we hear from residents about the specifics, and then we generally hold a vote on whether or not to request the DPW to take what is the first step in traffic calming, which is doing a traffic study and gathering data. And if that's done, it will come back to us and we consider it again and go forward from there. But the first thing, and that what we may be doing today, is voting on whether or not to do a traffic study. But first, we want to hear from residents, and so I would ask the primary signer of the application. I have Bobby O'Brien listed.
Bobby has since moved.
Okay. Who would you like to join as the
lead? I have inherited her mantle.
Would you please present the application to us?
Thank you.
Name and address.
Yeah, as Mr. Donald mentioned, a group of residents on North Farms Road, all along North Farms Road, submitted a request for traffic calming in the spring. And we have a number of concerns. I will present in outline form a summary of those concerns, and then residents of North Farms Road will be able to fill in some of the details.
Great, thank you. And would you give your name and address for the just our minutes, please?
I'm Bob Zimmerman, and I live at 549 North Farms Road.
Thank you.
Our concerns center on two issues. One is traffic volume, and the other is traffic speed on North Farms Road. The volume issues are that the number of vehicles using North Farms Road has increased steadily over the years. We think that a lot of the traffic is not coming from local residents, but from people to the west and to the north. We've never made a survey, so we can't be absolutely sure of that. It's also being used by an increasing number of trucks of all sorts, heavy trucks, dump trucks, 18-wheelers, and particularly timber-carrying trucks, which are extremely annoying. They seem to ignore the sign which says don't use engine brakes. They're very noisy and proceed usually down the hill of North Farms Road at what we think is an excessive speed. In addition, the trucks have exacerbated a situation that residents on North Farms Road have been upset with for many, many years, and that is the deplorable condition of the road surface at the bottom of the hill particularly in the area of the countryway and the parking lot to the Fitzgerald Lake Conservation Area, but it extends in both directions. Every winter, there are tire-breaking potholes in the road. They get repaired, they form again the next winter, or maybe even in some cases the same winter. And I'm afraid that both the large amount of traffic, the cars, SUVs, and so forth, together with the heavy trucks using the road, just tear it up and make the road even more difficult to navigate, particularly in the winter. The traffic speed issues are somewhat broader. People travel along North Orange Road at excessive speed. The speed limit is 35 miles an hour. Very frequently, when I'm going down the hill from my house on those very small straightaway patches that are present in the road, I'm passed by other cars going far faster than I. Another resident told me recently that he has the opposite problem, that when he's going north on North Orange Road, he's frequently passed by cars going faster, quite a bit faster than 35 miles an hour up the hill. So this is a primary problem. It also creates a significant safety issue. There's no sidewalk on North Orange Road, yet many people use it for walking. There are people using it with baby strollers, they're runners, and they're bicyclists. It's a favorite bicycle route in the city. And those people are really at peril from people using the road passing through at excessive speed. There are a number of curves on North Orange Road. It's a curvy road. In the winter in particular, it has led in many instances to the loss of control of the car or vehicle. There's been an accident. People's property has been damaged by cars going off the road. There are several blind driveways along North Orange Road. It is very difficult, particularly when they're on curves, for people leaving those driveways to clearly see the traffic to the right and to the left. And it is exacerbated in many cases by vegetation on the road which remains uncut. And some of that vegetation even obscures the signs that indicate that the speed limit is 35 miles per hour. It would be a great help if the DPW could trim vegetation and particularly keep the signs clear on North Orange Road throughout the summer, because we do have there's an annual mowing of the sides of the road, which normally takes place late in the summer or in fall. But from the course of the summer, there's a lot of growth which obscures both the road and some of the signs. The same vegetation reduces visibility, obviously, on the road and makes it more perilous for those using the road for walking and running, and bicycling, for that matter. North Orange Road intersects a wildlife corridor which connects the Fitzgerald Lake Conservation Area with undeveloped land to the west. I personally have seen a deer killed, I've seen a bear killed, I've seen bobcat killed, I've seen numerous small animals killed along the road. It's particularly perilous for rather defenseless animals like opossums and turtles, including state-listed species which have been swashed on the road, frogs, toads, and so forth. Although we've made representations to the Northampton Police about speed on North Farms Road, we see a police car checking speeds maybe once or twice a year, maybe three times a year. Ironically, there was a police car on North Farms Road today checking the speed of cars, but that is an unusual occurrence. So those are our concerns in summary, and I'm sure that my neighbors will fill in some of the details.
I appreciate that. Thank you very much. Is there anyone else who'd like to speak on this subject?
Yeah. I was
say something briefly. Excuse my coffee. I live at the very top of North Farms Road before the last curve as you go around.
And would you please...
It's one of the dangers.
I'm sorry to interrupt you. Would you give your name and address?
Oh, I'm sorry.
We all know who you are. It's famous.
I know
still.
You do. Yvonne Frichero. I live at 602 North Farms Road, which is almost at the end of North of Florence as before it gets to Hainville. Just above me, there is a steep curb. Rush hour traffic in the morning, the cars are speeding down and then having to come to a sudden halt by the school buses. So the clash between speeding cars and school buses is really difficult. it's also, the curb is rather a dangerous one in winter. Again, I know my neighbors tease me about this. I think if you look at the police records, you will find that there has been at least one accident a year within 100 feet of my driveway. It's a keen spot for both going up the hill and going down the hill. One of the things that has worried me recently is not only the speeding of the cars, but North Farms Road is a wonderful road for bicyclists. They love coming down that steep hill. However, if a bicyclist goes two or three abreast going down North Farms Road and there's a car coming up in the other direction, it spells trouble. I have many, many times followed very slowly behind a group of cyclists because I think it's too dangerous to pass them. I would repeat what my neighbor has said about the heavy trucks. When there's any construction going on or logging going on, some of the very, very heavy trucks come up. And actually, right at the point of my house and the kitchen is the point in the hill where you have to make an extra effort for trucks to get up, for cars to get up in the winter, because it's a very steep slope. So it's, I'm afraid, a site for traffic problems. Thank you for paying attention.
Thank you very much. Is anyone else who'd like to speak on this? Well, I forget your name and address.
Sorry. Hi, my name is Amy Levine. I live at 373 North Farms Road. And I would echo what Bob has said about speed. A number of us in my section of the road, as well as people north of us, have young children and are quite concerned about the speed. We have had several instances that have scared us. One, my husband was taking our dog for a walk and was at the edge of the road, and my son broke away from me, who's here, my toddler, broke away from me to get to my husband, and a pickup truck was coming up the street. My husband did this to the pickup truck. The pickup truck sped up and in reaction to us saying, calm down. My daughter, when she got on the bus for kindergarten, had an incident where, even though the bus was fully stopped with a stop sign out, a car just flew past it to get around it. We've had a number of instances where just been walking my dog, people come quite close to us. We feel that speed is a factor, but also kind of an aggressive driving, a culture of an aggressive driving. And perhaps North Farms Road is quite old. I mean, I know our house was built in the 1700s, and so before it was quite populated, I think that perhaps it's been a nice cut through to get north, especially without going 91 or Route 9 up and then up to Asheville. But there seems to be, not an acknowledgement of the people there and the way that we feel that it's our neighborhood. It's also quite a beautiful street, and I know the Broadbrook Association has expanded the city-owned land as part of the conservation efforts. And so I think not just the Fitzgerald Lake area should be considered as part of the public draw, but also the wider area. People come from other neighborhoods who run on our street. You know, they like the challenge of the hill. Bicyclists are frequent. Going up the hill, and they look thrilled to come down the hill because it's fun, and then you end up with the bike path. which is really three blocks away. But our concern is just that there isn't enough room for bicyclists and pedestrians with the road as it is. And one of the concerns with the deterioration of the road is that because we're a hill, the water has washed away the edges of the road in many cases. And so it's not just potholes that are annoying when you're driving, but it's for a bicyclist coming down, the road has actually been quite narrowed, and so they are at risk for going off the road and really having an accident because, as Buck said, there's quite, you know, it's in the country and we have lots of us have battled weeds in our backyards and our front yards. But there's quite a bit of vegetation on the edge of the street that I don't think the city could actually mow with a lawnmower. And I don't know if that's why because they do a good job around the drainage of the Broadbrook area, and they've taken care of mowing that, and it's out there. But there are a number of cases where the road, and I think this is because it's quite old, the land is like a hill. No one's yards are ever really leveled, and it's not like everyone keeps their yards nice and neat, but it's great, that's the country. We're glad we don't live in a cookie cutter neighborhood. But I have seen, like for example, on the bike path I saw the other day, this, I think it's city owned, has like a tractor with an arm that comes out and mows the edge. And we thought perhaps that could be used on our road. I don't know if it's only for the bike path. So we hope that you'll consider our application and before there's some horrible accident, not just with the animals, but with the people. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Is there anyone else who'd like to comment on this? Yes. Oh. We'll go in order of closeness.
My name is Athleen Zimmerman. I live at 549 North Farms Road. I'd just like to emphasize the extent of the noise pollution and the danger of trucks that use our road as a shortcut, especially big dump trucks who have, they're not going to local building sites. They're cutting across so they don't have to go on route. And they come down, we're at the bottom of that steep hill that Yvonne was talking about. They come down over 50 miles an hour. I mean, I've watched them time and time again. And when we first moved in, we had our dog who was right at the curb, because I was at the mailbox, killed by a pickup truck who was going up the hill. Because of the curb and, you know, the size of the road, they just zoom up there and they're like in third gear or something and they're not looking where they're going. Every time I go to a mailbox, cars come very close to me. It's especially dump trucks. And they put their, when they're coming down, they've got their brakes on and they're squealing and they're not supposed to use their brakes, but they do. I think every timber truck from Williamsburg uses that as a shortcut, but there's gotta be some way. I know you've kept trucks out of smaller streets in Northampton. They don't have the right to do that, and somebody is gonna get killed other than animals or an average getting killed on a street. But it is a rural road. We move there because we love the rural aspect of it. And then especially, you know, every morning and every afternoon we get this noise and pollution and danger.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Yes, sir.
Hi, my name is Brian Levine. I live at 373 North Farmers Road with my wife, who just spoke. I know your time is valuable, so I'll just say a couple of brief points. I want to reiterate that I've had all these same experiences. I've had cars pass me on the way down the road. I've had cars pass me on the way up the road. There's something about that the road is very steep pitch that cars feel they have to get really revved up before they approach going up the hill. Two other things to tell you are that I live very close to the bike path, relatively close. I've never once gotten on my own road with my kids on bikes to go to the bike path. I bought two bike racks for my car to take a 5-minute trip down to the bike path because I just will not risk my kids' life. Similarly, it scares us every night when we take our dog out for a walk that both of our kids want to go, because now that we have a 7-year-old daughter, I feel like she's old enough to stay on the grass, but to control a dog, and then another child, and then my toddler at the same time. It's very odd to me to live in a country part of town and not be able to go on my own road as if I'm somewhere in the middle of New York City. So Thanks very much for your time.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Hi, I'm Andrew Kennan, 372 North Farms Road. I'm going to look a little bad here. My wife is one of the people who runs on North Farms Road. I bike on North Farms Road every day, including tomorrow morning. I'll be taking my son in a trailer down North Farms Road to the bike trail, get on the bike trail. I do it maybe defiantly, but I'm always nervous when I'm biking on North Farms Road. I bike every single day. I'm a commuter, and I also cycle for exercise. And I do find that cars rev up. I mean, I'm at the same spot where Brian is and Amy are, and cars rev up as they go up that hill. And I noticed it the day I moved in. You know, we were sleeping in the room for the first time, windows open in May, and around 1 a.m., pickup truck after pickup truck. I could just hear the revving and the engines going, I actually asked Brian about it, like, is it always that loud? And I've just gotten used to it, I think. But I do think the road does attract a lot of traffic attention that could somehow either be slowed down or diverted some other way. And I think, you know, it is extremely popular for cyclists. It's a little self-serving, but I do think more protection for cyclists and runners would do a great deal of good for the road. That's all I wanted to say. Thank you.
Okay. We appreciate that. Thank you. Is there anyone else who'd like to comment on the North Lawrence Road traffic calming application? Okay. Well, we'll shift away to public comment for the time being. As a commission, I'd invite any comments or discussion from the members of the commission.
I think that road is in terrible condition. My first question is, when is it due to be redone? Do we know? It's in really bad shape.
I don't know. Director of the DPW, traffic engineer, might have some sense, or maybe it's not been calculated.
We have a waterline project in the vicinity that is on the docket. Maggie, is that on the pavement list for next year?
We haven't looked at next year's paving projects yet, so I don't know. I'm not sure where it falls.
Discussion item? Discussion points?
Discussion. Clarification. I think a few of you said this, that cars pass you. You mean you're in your car and cars are illegally crossing the double yellow? That's what we hear.
There's no double.
There's no line.
There's no line.
But there.
Do you feel like that would be helpful if there was a line?
No, I think
they would do the same thing. I think also they view it as something akin to bridge road, like a main artery,
yeah,
that allows them to go that fast.
Well, Bob, would you want to?
If I could just make one more comment about resurfacing the road. I talked to the previous DPW director about this in the spring, and he told me that the replacement of the water pipe was going to take place in August of this year. It hasn't yet begun, and that will only go from Arcanum Field to Countryway. He told me that the resurfacing of the rest of the Farms Road would be at least $1 million job and would be in competition with several other $1 million jobs in the city for next year or the year after or the indefinite future.
I'd suggest a number of issues have been brought up. There are sort of immediate issues. There's a question of things like vegetation and mowing. There's a question of, you know, resurfacing the road. I'd like to actually put those aside for the time being. It doesn't mean we can't follow up on them, but I'd like to focus our discussion right now on the actual traffic calming application. And so, frankly, I think our process is to vote on it. So let's just put this forward as a motion so we can actually have a decision one way or the other today. So I'd accept the motion on whether or not, I accept the motion to ask the DPW to take the first step in traffic calming and gather some data for the traffic.
So moved.
Okay, so that's made and seconded. We have an actual motion before us. The other kind of administrative things I think we should follow up on by email. But to the question of whether or not to proceed with the traffic calming process, is there any discussion on that motion?
What kind of timing is there on that? We have limitations, don't we, on the stuff we can use to traffic calm with?
Yep, that's in seasonal limitations as well. I mean, that's a question for the DPW.
Well, the traffic counters cannot be put out during the winter because they'll be ripped up by snow plows.
And you have one, at least one, to do yet, I believe, Federal Street.
Federal Street, yeah. Right, next.
Any other?
I have a question about traffic calming. Does the city put out, I know in some other towns around us, they have these signs saying, check your speed. They also, other places have, you know, speed monitored. And there's no signs like that in North Farms Road. Could that be part of traffic calming?
That's again, I know the police department has done that elsewhere.
No, right.
That's something that I think we can maybe discuss. But I'd like to separate that out from the question of whether we're going to do a full traffic study to gauge speed. The traffic study will gauge speed, traffic volume, types of vehicles, the number of axles. And we'll come back with this information. The reason is we want to make decisions based on solid data. So that's the purpose of the motion. Right now, is there any other discussion on this motion? Okay. All in favor of asking the DPW to do this, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Thank you very much. So the process is now, we've asked the DPW to do this. When I know more, I'll talk with the residents, and I'll let you know when this is back on the agenda for the next step of the conversation. Meanwhile, feel free to be in touch with me. Okay.
Thank you very much.
Appreciate
it. Thank you
very much. Okay, and thank you. I promised Councilor LaBarge about 5 o'clock in the spot, and we're right on that, so I'd like to invite her up. I'd like to shift to items 9B and 9C. These are issues related to traffic on Park Hill Road, and also issues related to traffic at the intersection of West Hampton Road and Glendale Road. And Councilor, I don't know if you'd like to introduce this.
Thank you. Councilor O'Donnell, you also received a letter from Laura Mesa to the rest of the
issue. Yes. Because
I printed
out something. Okay. You have extras for home.
Thank you. Okay, I received a call from a new resident that moved into Ward 6 on Park Hill Road on the corner of Whittier. And they've been with us probably about 4 months. And I can see where they're having a serious problem. It has been a problem for quite a long time. And apparently, when they bought their home, they were not told by the realtor, which I'm having a problem out in Ward 6 with this, of not being told how heavily trafficked a road is. Anyways, if you have read the letter from both of the girls that live on Park Hill Road, they have a child, and across the street on Whittier, on the corner, are a gamut of two other small children. And it's become a serious problem. The speeding is unbelievable. I did a site visit, and I have to thank Donna again for coming to the Park Hill Road area with me to look at the concerns that the two residents had. And Donna, thank you. Today I went down there again. And the old sign has been removed. It's an antique. It should have been taken out of there a long time. But coming in from Florence Road to Park Hill Road, I'm just giving an estimate because I'm not an engineer. There's a speed sign 30 miles an hour, probably about 50 or 60 feet. Then a children's sign, which is about 100 feet at the intersection from Florence Road to Park Hill Road. If you go past Autumn Drive, there's a very, very bad curve, very bad. And that is probably about 150 feet, the most, before you come to house number 75 on Park Hill Road, which is where we're having some serious problems. So visibility coming out of their driveway, I've had a problem. I can't answer for Councilor Ryan, but I had a problem coming out of that driveway three times. So I've asked Donna to come and do a site visit with me, which she did. And the children's sign is gone. I have received an email from my two residents, and I thank you for that. And her and I looked at specifically areas of placing the signs, because the way they had them placed did not make sense at all. Here you come out of their driveway, and there's a children's sign. You're coming down from all the way to the end of Park Hill Road, down to Whittier, and the children's sign is facing this way. It's ridiculous. But we're changing that, and I thank you for that. Also, I would like to see a sign being placed of something to deal with the visibility of that driveway, somehow with the Department of Public Works, like a hidden driveway, because that is a problem. There's no question about it. So I don't know if that can be done or not, but I would like you to look into that. Also, past Autumn Drive, you're going to see probably about up to house number 201. The speed limit automatically, it goes 30 miles an hour, then up to house number 201, the speed limit goes 40 miles an hour. 40 miles an hour. And I'm talking about a very curvy, curvy road. Very curvy. We've had some serious accidents there several years ago where I received a call at 11:45 at night that somebody had hit a tree, which was some young kids. But the parents were very concerned because they had small children. So this is all not making sense here. Here we have a speed sign at 30 miles an hour. The road is fine. All of a sudden, all these curves, and it's 40 miles an hour. Then we go back again to the speed limit of 30 miles an hour, which is right after house number 483. It's just not making sense. It's a straight road. I'm hoping that eventually, with transportation and parking, and with the Department of Public Works and the police department, somehow we can put our heads together and either make the speed limits equal. Go 30 miles an hour or maybe 35 miles an hour and make it all even, just like Florence Road, a big problem going on with that. We were told we could not change that speed limit. The laws have changed and they can be done. I would like to see which Laura and Lisa have suggested to both Ryan, Councilor Ryan O'Donnell and I, a traffic comment being done, possibly of speed bumps being placed. And now I'm being told by people our city of Northampton now is called speed bumps. And I agree with that. I think they're very successful. And we've got one coming up on Florence Road. Thank you, Councilor O'Donnell. It was in dire need. So I am requesting, because the residents have asked both Councilor Ryan O'Donnell and I, of a traffic study to be done and traffic calming and seeing if they qualify for speed humps in that area. And I cannot say where to put them, but they would like them somewhere before their homes and after their homes. So that's another thing there. But I'm really looking at a hidden driveway sign, so I'm hoping that that can be looked at. The speeding is terrible.
Okay. Well, Councilor, would you like to describe your concerns about West Hampton Road as well? And then...
Yes. Okay. West Hampton Road, the intersection of West Hampton Road, Glendale Road, and West Farms Road. Both Don and I did a site visit on that area. I don't know what we're going to do for it, but I think a traffic study, traffic coming, should be done on that site also. We've had two accidents there, and I have to say this last accident with a little child in the back seat of the car coming off of Glendale Road and hit another car, spun around and went across the street, and you saw some of the vehicle's parts. Thank you for having them pick that up. The speeding is terrible. Terrible on West Hampton Road. And I have to say our police department, they're doing the best they can. We only have so many police officers and they only can go when they are needed. And I want to thank our police department for showing the visibility to the best that you can. And hopefully we'll have more police officers so that you can stretch and get them all over the place, because it's a big problem. So that is my concerns.
Yeah, we appreciate it.
Glendale Road, West Farms Road, and West Stanton Road. And also, I do want to say that even being on site, we made 6 site visits that day. And we have a serious problem on Glendale Road. The speeding is absolutely terrible. And it's the same problem that you're hearing everywhere. It's a connection coming off from West Stanton to go to East Stanton. And Wayne and I had a site visit, and the speeding was terrible at 6:30 at night. And Wayne, you were there. It was awful. So I'm saying something needs to be done. I know we've asked the police to show presence there, which they have periodically, but something needs to be done. We need traffic calming done or something to control the speeding.
Well, we really appreciate it. I think it was important for you to give us information to the members of the commission so we all know about what's going on. And perhaps the best thing is to continue the discussion between you and I and the DPW about what steps might be appropriate.
That would be great.
Okay. Well, we thank you very much for your
thank
time.
You. Thank you. About
this. Thank you, Councilman. I'd like to, respecting our time, try and move on as quickly as possible. Councilor Bidwell is here and brings us to item 9D. This is stop signs, other signage, and issues of traffic and traffic calming at the intersection of Vernon Street, Washington Place, and Federal Street. Councilor, would you like to tell us what's going on?
Thank you, Councilor. I'm glad we got to that section of your agenda where politicians do.
Right. Politicians are,
I guess you're one of the others. It's been brought to my attention by 3 residents in the last 2 or 3 months, 2 on Vernon Street and 1 on Washington Place, that what is an intersection that has 2 stop signs, but there have been frequent, I'm told, I haven't verified this independently, accidents over the last 3 or 4 years and near accidents, because people are coming up the federal, let me describe the intersection. I didn't come equipped with visuals. There's a fairly steep hill coming up Federal. There's no stop sign at the top of that, and I don't think there should be. And Federal then, as it crosses Vernon, becomes Washington Place. There are stop signs at both kind of both directions at Vernon Street. The problem is that through traffic coming up Federal and crossing over Vernon and Washington, they're not asked to stop. They're not given any warning of it being a kind of a dangerous intersection. The danger is enhanced by the fact that at the corner of Vernon and Washington Place, there's a great deal of shrubbery on private property that really obscures anyone seeing traffic coming in that direction. So folks have said to me, we need a 4-way stop. Personally, I don't think a 4-way stop would be appropriate. I don't think a stop sign at the top of that steep hill would make any sense. But a stop sign at Washington Place, perhaps, if studies bear it out, might make some sense. And perhaps a sign as you're coming up Federal, I don't think a stop sign, but approaching intersection or some variation of that sign, just to give folks a heads up that as they're zooming up that hill, at the top of that hill, where their own visibility is somewhat limited, they should be aware of an intersection approaching. So, if it seems appropriate, I think some measure of study from DPW would be appropriate.
Great. Thank you very much, first of all, and comments from the commission, in particular DPW, our traffic engineer. Any thoughts on this?
Coming up Federal Street, there's no stop sign at the top of the hill.
Correct.
And they just go straight across Vernon into Washington Place?
Correct. And the same in the other direction. Come Washington Place, just continue on without a stop sign to go down Federal and to make a turn there. Correct. I was interested that there will be a traffic volume study, if I heard you say, on Federal?
For Federal, that's between Nonotuck and Riverside Drive.
Yes, that.
So that's
a different section of Federal. I'm not so sure that in this section of Federal, the overall volume is an issue so much as the limited sight lines and the tendency to speed a little bit up the hill.
I know in the past, kind of one-page studies of stop signs that have been proposed have been completed by the DPW. One was done for Henry Street, for example. I know you have many things on your plate, but I don't know if that's a possibility to just, you know, do an analysis so we know whether, you know, signage would be warranted in this location. I hope that's possible.
We could look into signage. I'm not sure exactly what will be going up there, but something I can look into.
Okay. Because you do look at traffic volume, and you look at sight lines, and you look at accident data.
So traffic counters
would
need to go
in that
location to get the volume.
Oh, okay.
So
I see.
Is the certain amount of volume is necessary to trigger a stop sign?
Yes. I mean if you're say it's a main street and then you want to be stopped at the side street, the main street needs to have enough volume to warrant that stop. If there's gaps on the main line, you wouldn't necessarily need to always stop.
That makes sense. I just suggest that I'm not sure here it's so much a question of volume. It's just what happens when those cars that are there have very limited sight lines to see what's going on. Okay.
It might just be the signage warning that there's an intersection ahead, because it might not be warranted for a stop sign. Once we did a study.
So the zoning standard for vegetation is you should make an imaginary triangle within 25 feet of the corner of the lot, where the lot hits Federal and Vernon, mm-hmm. going back 25 feet each direction in a triangle that can have vegetation over 3 feet high. Would that make a difference?
If the vegetation were cut.
So a zoning complaint could be filed with the building inspector, and he could follow up with asking people to trim the vegetation down.
Well, that's true. That would certainly in excess of 3 feet now. So that would help. I just think it might make some sense to study whether signage would be appropriate as well.
Okay. Well, you know, amidst all the DPW is doing, is it possible to ask you to make a determination on signage for a future meeting for this commission?
Sure, we can discuss and make a recommendation.
That would be, I think, much appreciated.
Yes.
Okay.
Much appreciated. Thanks.
Thank you. All right. Let's see. Making good progress here. Let's take care of the ones we've skipped. Five reports from departments and subcommittees.
Just to quickly, we did we have now a crowdfunding fundraising campaign going on for the Cracker Barrel Alley. Since we've been meeting, we've had six different people contribute. So all day long, it keeps beeping as people contribute. So that's really been great. And then our bike ped committee had their second to last review of the draft bike, walk bike Northampton plan. We're hearing comments. The consultant will be back in a month from now, and we'll be finalizing. Just so it's clear, we're asking the consultant to finalize the plan isn't their recommendations. We're not doing the public process at this point. So what we end up with is a consultant's report that's not a city plan. And then we come back to the comprehensive plan, then we'll have a whole new public process to get
it. Okay. Any discussion on that?
Okay.
Any other departmental updates, DPW updates?
Paving project for Spit Road will be paved tomorrow. Contractor is currently in the process of doing line painting on the other streets that have been paved. Calling, we collect data for tunnels. For Nonotuck Street, two temporary speed humps have been placed between Landy Ave and New Street. Florence Road, we are preparing to install the permanent speed tables, hopefully at the end of this month. Sidewalk inventory. We have Alta Planning and Design doing citywide sidewalk inventory. They have subbed out innovative data from Belchertown to collect the data. you may have seen them around with the wheelchairs and the tablet on it. So they're collecting data during this month. The tax ceiling is starting up again tomorrow. So short list of streets will be doing that. The city and line painting will be another contractor coming in to do line painting.
Thank you very much. Any questions on the DPW update? Just briefly, do you have an idea when Federal Street might be scheduled? It's next. It's imminent. Okay, fair enough. Thank you. Item six, any announcements or presentations? No announcements, I assume. 7B, skip this one. 7B is a request that a number of 15-minute parking spaces be established in the vicinity of a new business called the Good Dog Spot at 139 King Street. There's no one here to speak on that. Oh, sir.
Thank you.
You're here? Okay.
My name's Rich Mowitz. I'm at 150 Main Street. Wayne's left, but Wayne and Carolyn have been very helpful in the planning process. We've lost Corey, but Elizabeth Staples is the owner of the Good Dog Spot. Their second location. They have one in Chicopee that's very successful, and they're expanding to Northampton. Over the last couple of months, we've done a lot of renovations in the building, trying to realty on the outside, and Corey and Elizabeth on the inside. They've done a great job. It's a really interesting operation, and I encourage you to stop by and perhaps bring your pet. It's really a doggy daycare on steroids. It's quite something to see. Our request is fairly simple. We're looking to put 2 15-minute parking spaces in front of the building as people drop off their pets. All the surrounding buildings have dedicated parking. This is a large-scale building. It's 12,700 square feet. And we're hoping you consider accommodating this business owner's request. They're young, very talented, very hardworking entrepreneurs.
Thank you very much. Any questions or comments from the commission about this?
Just to clarify, this is Main Street or King Street?
Sorry, 139 King Street.
King Street, okay.
Right, just north of North.
Where is that? Right?
It's the former Hamlin Furniture Building.
Oh, okay.
So it's next to International Auto Parts and King Auto Body.
Okay. I remember the work's been going on out front.
Considerable work, yes.
Thank you.
And there's no off-street parking for your building, is that correct?
No, there was at one point when in back of the building, but the bike path has kind of eliminated that. And over time, the building's parking has kind of been usurped by neighbors. There used to be a sort of a good working relationship, but that's fallen apart over the last decade or so.
Okay.
So the parking would be exceptionally helpful to their operation.
Any other thoughts or questions?
And I think they have an open house, can I say this?
Yeah.
Tomorrow at 4:30, if anyone is interested in seeing it, quite something to see.
Is there an alpha parking? Is it metered parking?
No, there are two spaces right in front of the building, and that's what we're seeking to make is 15-minute parking spaces. So you drop your dog off, you walk in, you go to the reception area, and then you hop back in your car.
So there are two spaces there now that are
correct.
Parking that are not metered.
That are not metered and that are smack in front of the building.
I see. So you're trying to limit people from parking there all day and allow for a 15-minute drop.
Right.
Got it. Thanks.
I guess my question is, obviously there's no business at that location currently, but I never see anyone in those spots. That's my only question about this.
Actually, if I could comment on that.
Please.
Since we've been in there, which has been literally going on now, a week and a half. It's not a problem on slow days, like say Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, but you start to get into Thursday, Friday, and especially on Saturday, there can be people there all day long. This past Saturday, I got there at maybe 9, and there was already a car there, and it didn't leave till two cars there, and one of them didn't leave till 3, and one of them was still there when I left at 5. So it doesn't seem to be a consistent problem, but we're not in the building long enough to see if it is or not. What we're really looking to, one of the things we really deliver is consistency, and these people are coming in to get, they're busy, they're on their way to work. So the idea is to be able to move people in and out quickly, and if you take a spot like that, somebody's got to park down the street, around the corner, you know, and cross busy streets with their pets, it just inconveniences them, which, you know, could be bad for us.
So there is no other parking?
Correct.
Well, you right can, at your well, building. So
right, right.
Well, there are other spots along King Street,
correct,
in the area.
Correct. Where we're at, it's like right past that intersection, so there's really not a ton. I mean, there's the metered parking before you get to the light, and then after that, there's just the couple of spots in front of those buildings. And then you get down to Foster Farrar and what used to be Northampton Honda there. And there's not a ton right in that immediate area. A short walk, yes, but.
And all the other buildings have dedicated parking lots, so this is sort of a standalone building. It really has a short-term parking need.
I mean, have you considered just, I mean, you're not open yet. I mean, have you considered just seeing what it's like when you open before we change
the We've been open since the 12th, so we have been watching it. And before that, we were watching, well, for pretty much the months of July and August while we were doing our construction. So like I said, it's not every day, all day, but it certainly is, you know, especially on days like a Saturday where I think people are just coming to town to, you know, to hang out a little bit more. Like a slower day for us is a Monday or Tuesday. We haven't seen much problem with it then. It's a problem in the evening when people are coming to pick up, and again, it seems like a Saturday is a big draw.
I just had two questions about that. What is your drop-off time in the morning? What are we talking about?
Busy times for us are between 7 and 9:30, and then again between like 4 and 6:30. So those are the busy windows. And other than that, we have a client or two checking in for grooming, but it's not the same rush, you know, for people to get to work or get home from work.
And I guess part B of this is that a 15-minute spot is enforced 8 a.m. to 6 p.m. Mm-hmm. Outside of that, it's no longer a 15-minute spot.
From what time?
8 a.m. to 6 p.m.
Okay.
So and you're saying that you're going to have people coming in. I mean, when I used to drop off my dog, it would be first thing in the morning.
Right.
That's the big rush time because everybody wants to bring their dogs in. So how would that affect it if you're having people come in at 7 o'clock in the morning, but the 15-minute spot doesn't start until 8 a.m.?
It's a 1 hour thing, and you know, like I said, our busy time is from 7 to, I'd say 9 or 9:30.
Okay.
You know, and when we've been watching like our Chicopee traffic, it seems like on average, you know, 4 spots for us is about, you know, if we really hustle in the lobby and move the dogs through, 4 to 6 spots is about it, you know, that we need at one time. So between having those 2 spots would at least mean that some of our clients could get in and out quicker, and therefore we'd be able to move the turnaround. You know, our fear is just kind of souring people on the idea of being like, oh, it's not worth my time. I've got to find a place to park and then bring the dog and, you know, that sort of thing. So we're just looking to make it as convenient as possible. And the same thing on the end of the day. It's not the same rush to get to work, but it certainly is, you know, if you're tired, you want to get home. You don't want to have to walk, especially in the rain or the snow.
I just wouldn't want the impression to be there that it's going to be enforced prior to that.
I understand that, but if it's not enforced till 8, but somebody parked there at 7, I mean, really by 8 o'clock it's enforced, so we'd still have some bearing for that remaining period, right?
I'm just curious, you know, if the big problem is like a day like Saturday where I presume people are parking there and walking the town, wouldn't like a 1 hour limit be just as good?
I only reference Saturday because it's one of the, like, I was just happened to be there this past Saturday and noticed that both the spots were taken, you know, pretty much all day. You know, we were saying 15 minutes because, again, we just want to be able to get people in and out. And an hour, you know, is certainly a little bit much to get people in and out. And I believe the spot in front of International Auto is I don't know if it's 15, but it's certainly got a limit on it as well.
Thank you. Any other concerns? Questions about this?
How many spots are there along that stretch of King, like from, you know, lights to the hardware store?
That's a good question.
I believe there's 4. There should be one in front of what was that adult store, if my memory is correct, and maybe not because that's so close to the curb. There's one in front of the auto parts, there's 2 in front of ours, and then there is, and that's it. There isn't one in front of King Auto because there's a fire hydrant there. So there's 4 max, maybe 3.
And the other thing to consider is, well, I guess two things. One is it's not right downtown. It's a highway business, so that changes things a little bit. But the dry cleaner, for example, you know, that'll have like maybe one 50-minute space. And they probably get a lot quicker. equivalent number of customers, I would think, during rush hour. So.
This is 10 times the space of the dry cleaners. It's a large scale building.
Okay.
And I would just like to say that safety wise, having people park across the street and go through King Street through three or four lanes of traffic is not optimal. So if you can do the 15 minute spaces, that largely solves the traffic flow in and out of the Good Dog Spot.
Just to give you an idea, our Chicopee location, we currently have around 55 to 60 dogs a day. So that's, it's a large number. I mean, it's not there yet, but that's certainly our hope, is that it's going to be a larger number of dogs coming in and out.
And how many spaces do you have that turnover the way you have in
Chicopee? Yeah.
Well,
in Chicopee, we're in an old mill building, so there's an actual, like, dedicated parking lot. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, when we've been really kind of tracking it, six is a busy number for us. You know, it really depends on how quickly we can get the dogs in and out. So we were hoping that, you know, there's the 2-15 minutes would, some of our traffic stays longer. A new client would want to see the place, you know, spend a little more time. We've been talking to them on the phone and getting them, you know, telling them where to, you know, kind of places to go, or guiding them where to park, and to hopefully free up those two spots for the folks we know, the folks that are coming regularly, who can just kind of get in and out, just to speed up the flow.
What other questions? I mean, I haven't personally spoken to adjacent businesses. We're talking about four spots, so I would like to do that.
Sure. We've spoken with King Auto.
Okay.
And they said for insurance purposes, they can't be of any help to us.
Oh, it just provided you.
Right. Whether it was for our clients or our staff, they were, for insurance purposes, they can't do anything with us. We recently were able to reach somebody at the auto parts store who said they didn't have a problem with a few of our employees parking back there, but they were concerned about the flow of traffic in and out of that back lot because they have the delivery trucks coming, the big trucks, and it's a narrow area. So they were a little concerned about increasing the flow, I mean, from clients and things like that.
Sure.
Staff that were parking in the morning and staying for a period of time, they seemed a little bit better about.
Did they have a comment about whether those 15-minute spaces would have an impact on their business?
On theirs? Well, I don't think so, because King Auto Body, right now, it appears to me that they're using most of, like, the empty Midas building that's there, and then the auto parts place, they do mostly deliveries. It doesn't seem, they don't have really a retail or a walk-in traffic. They're, you know, I think their primary, their parts are all delivered to local auto places.
And both buildings, two buildings on either side, have large dedicated parking lots. So, you know, there's easy access for their customers.
Right, right.
I can't see this affecting their businesses
right. In
any material way.
So we are kind of talking about a universe of three businesses, really. I mean, no one really crosses King Street, you know, freely in that way. So it's kind of like these four parking spaces serve three buildings. And so if all three buildings, I mean, even though it's a public street, if all three owners of the building are okay with it, that would be significant for me.
Yeah, I was just trying to, if anybody has a sense of who's using those spaces. I mean, I can't imagine people are parking there and walking to Main Street, as we heard from the mayor, that they're looking to park in front of the business. And they wouldn't be parking there to walk across the street to Dunkin' Donuts or whatever. Do you think it's employees of the businesses around you or residents?
No, I don't. And I've been trying to keep an eye out, but with everything else going
sure.
on, it ends up falling off of my radar, and then all of a sudden you're just like, oh, you know, the cars are gone. I really have no idea who it would be parking out there.
There are also two spaces dedicated right in front of the building as well. So when we say four parking spaces, two on the street, two in front of the building.
Well, procedurally, to do this anyway, we need an actual ordinance that would change the rules in our code. And we don't have a ordinance before us today, so in any event, it would take at least, you know, till next time for us to look at an actual instrument that would change the rules. So if we do that, it would probably afford some time to, I would like to check personally with the adjacent businesses. But that's just my preference. Having said that, anyone absolutely free to make a motion on this item if they wish today. But if not, I would suggest, I mean, the city council has to come back with an ordinance at some point anyway. So. All right, I I'm sensing the will of the commission is just to leave it here and wait till we have an ordinance to approve.
Can I ask, Maggie, can someone give you a draft so we have it at the next meeting? So
okay.
Okay,
thank you. Great.
Thank you for your time.
Some progress. Thank you very much. All right. Now we're down to 9A. This is the request of Mr. Albert Fisher, a discussion of LED street lighting. So I'll turn it over to
him. Thank you, Ryan. So I know there's been plenty of conversation about the LED street lights that are coming to us in other meetings. And I guess I'm probably a little late getting up to speed on it, but as I read through the documentation and whatnot, it occurred to me that, you know, there's a public safety aspect to this, and as the Transportation Commission, maybe we want to have a voice here. And so specifically, and I guess I'll also say that the city committees and staff seem to have been great in reacting to public comment and other things and changing the lamps to these 3000K lamps that aren't as blue and addressing concerns about light trespass and into people's homes and whatnot. But the thing that still stood out for me was the glare that comes off of these fixtures for the drivers of vehicles. And, or, you know, the literature calls it disability glare, like glare that's bad enough that it affects your ability to see and operate your vehicle safely. And so my question, I guess, for the people here who are involved to whatever extent is, do we feel as a city and staff here that we understand that issue well enough with the design of the fixtures that are there? And I say that because when you read the AMA report that seems to be pretty widely cited in all of these conversations, they're very clear that the fixtures should be shielded for that purpose. I understand the shields are not only to achieve, you know, reducing the glare of these things, but nevertheless, I think there's something to address here.
Thoughts, comments?
You're saying a shield is the only way to
help? I'm not trying to be the engineer here. I mean, I'm an engineer, but I'm a software engineer, so I don't know very much on this. I understand that shields are one way of reducing that glare by, you know, just blocking the angle that the light comes out of the fixture. But I'm sure there's other ways to do it. And the shields seem to have been somewhat controversial for whatever reason. I don't may not understand. My chief concern is just that people operating vehicles, you know, we all get behind the wheel of our cars and we drive with lethal force. And glare has been a factor in accidents here in town and even deaths. And I think that before we install 2,000 of these fixtures around town, we ought to have a really good understanding of what's going to happen there. And if we don't have that understanding, well, what are the proper steps to take so that we do have it?
What's our role in this regarding this?
Well, I mean, obviously, this has been an issue of a lot of community discussion, and it's focused on different elements. Some has been color, some has been shielding. For this commission, and I think if we're going to talk about this, as Mr. Albert Fisher says, it's a very narrow consideration, yeah, entirely about how it would affect drivers and visibility. I guess that would be the idea.
Oh, yeah, exactly. No, I mean, so then I'll throw out a few ideas here. So rather than installing the 2,000 fixtures, is there anything to prevent us from installing on one arterial to get a better understanding of how they work? And we have like six lamps or something installed right now. I've gone by them, I've taken a look. I don't think there's enough of them to really understand the effect of glare as you're driving by, at least subjectively as a single driver going by there. Why not do a whole roadway, for instance?
Well, I guess I would ask Director Pomerantz, since in the past you've proved yourself knowledgeable about this and you're very involved with it, could you speak to the issue of glare lights and the kind of
from a scientific standpoint, no.
Okay. But it's been a consideration the city has.
Obviously, you know,
I'm available.
You know, this is an initiative that we've put forward from my administration. It's something that the city council has funded the capital investment for. We've had, you know, the Energy and Sustainability Commission is sort of the one that's been providing primary advice and guidance. And I think there's several members of that commission that are also on transportation and parking. And we have listened to concerns. We've swapped out, tried different fixtures. And we have a plan for a pretty aggressive shielding regime when we do install the lights, and then we're going to take a look at it. So that's the position of the city, and I believe we've gone to great lengths. We're actually the ones that set up the public comment process and put out the, you know, it was not in response to public comments. We actually were seeking public input, and I think we've been responsive to it. We've tried different fixtures. We've delayed implementation of the project to try different fixtures, and obviously we want to make sure that they're safe. We want to make sure that we do minimize glare. We also want to maximize energy efficiency for the city. So, so that's where we are in this process.
And the issue of glare has been something the city examined and looked at.
It is,
it's
yes.
Not something that was ignored.
Not at all, not at all. And I would submit to you that if you go stand out in that parking lot tonight and stare at the street light, that's out there now, you'll experience glare. I mean, that is an issue with all streetlights. And so we are looking at, we've looked at ratings of glare. That's been an issue that's come up in the public, from the public input we've had, that this light is going to have less glare, even though the glare rating is the same. We've installed it, and sure enough, it looks the same. So these are tested for glare and for glare rating, and to be rated to be on roadways and streets. So we're mindful of that. And we're going to try to be responsive when we get, you know, specific complaints about a specific light. We can certainly go take a look at it. And we are going to be being aggressive about some shielding, not as aggressive as some people have requested, but in the early deployment. So
it sounds like there is a glare rating, whatever that might be, some numerical value,
mm-hmm.
and we're within, I guess, norms. We would be on par with other communities. I guess that's. Would answer the basic question.
Well,
I
guess what I would say is, first of all, I'm in complete support of this project. I actually think it's fantastic, and I appreciate your efforts and everyone that has been on this. My understanding is that the glare remediation that's planned is for light trespass, you know, into people's homes and whatnot, and that there's not necessarily anything planned for glare to drivers and vehicles. That I know of, and I'm a novice here, so I'm just here to ask the questions and make sure, try and make sure the city is the right choice here. And so, if that's the case, and how would we address that? You know, like, so say we move forward with that, and is that something we're open to measuring, as the AMA article suggests, and making changes for if necessary?
I think it's something that we'll take a look at. I think the request has been made. At least the main request I've heard is that they want the lights to be fully shielded, which kind of defeats the purpose of having the lights in the first place and going with the type of fixture that we have. There's a request for a cul-de-sac shield on every light, and a cul-de-sac shield is a specific application, as opposed to a home shield where if it's out in front of your house, it's shielded from going. So,
and that's why I'll just add that. That's why I was specific to say I don't know if shielding is exactly the thing, because I'm not trying to make this an issue about dark sky and all these other things, which I support and I think they're great, but there's a real, to me, it's the public safety issue of glare to drivers, especially elderly who are susceptible to that. And the LED lights, from what I've read, while they have the same lumens or whatever it is that the other fixtures have, these are pointed, the LEDs are points of light, and the AMA article is clear that should not be in the field of vision of drivers.
Mm-hmm.
That's my concern, really.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, a totally legitimate issue to raise. Sounds like there has been some thinking done on this part of the city. Anything else?
What is the rollout schedule? Do we have that schedule?
Construction starts beginning of October. Installation.
Yeah, October.
Item 10 is two items that were continued. I'd like to, unless any objection, continue them again. Any objection to it? Okay. Those are continued. Any new business today? Is a motion to adjourn?
Can I? Am I new business? Can I say something?
Sure.
Okay.
Would you like to come up and give your name and address, please?
Sure. My name is Rachel Blod. I live at 269 Main Street. I work at 263 Main Street. I am here because of a parking situation. And my concern is that the way that the process currently works, when you get a ticket and then you get a penalty notification in 21 days, is it? Is it 21? Yes. And before that 21 days, there's never any notification of having a parking ticket. So if you didn't get the ticket for whatever reason, wind, somebody passing by, somebody thinking they're doing you a favor and taking the ticket off, I don't know, whatever it may be. If you don't get the ticket, then you're automatically penalized for not paying the ticket. In my case, I have a motorcycle that is obviously an open vehicle. And the day that I received a ticket, I didn't get the ticket. And I think the same reason I didn't receive the ticket is probably the same reason that I got a ticket, meaning that the wind likely blew off my little, you know, pay park ticket. And likely also blew off the ticket that was from, you know, the parking violation department. And in that, I mean, I know that on a car there's typically easier ways to attach the ticket and you get it, or for whatever reason. But I think that in terms of those people that actually don't get it, and in terms of just a, you know, the quality of the community and a good, you know, policy in general that gives benefit of the doubt to its people, would be to have a notification sent that, hey, just a reminder, you did get a ticket. And also, if you don't pay it, say, in 10 days, you will get an additional penalty. Rather than instant penalty.
Okay. Well, I appreciate that. We're going to count that as public comment, and one of our rules is we can't engage in back and forth in public comment. Because we didn't post this item in advance, and we're required to do that before we discuss something.
Well,
so
I wasn't,
we appreciate your...
I was just told to come. I didn't know that there was a posting of any kind. Is there a way to know?
Well, we're not, you know, we don't adjudicate parking tickets or anything like that, but your comment about our
well,
process
is
something.
Well, I paid the ticket. It's not, like, that's not the issue. I was just doing
this. Yeah, no, I got it. Yeah. No, I'm saying we appreciate hearing that. We just can't have a discussion.
Okay, so how do I go about it so that there is a discussion if there needs to be one?
Well, you can email me as the chair if you want, and we can discuss whether or not it could be on a future agenda.
Okay.
I don't know offhand if it would be appropriate to do so.
For a later time.
Yes.
Okay, great.
So thank you very much.
Thank you.
No new business? Okay, motion to adjourn.
Move to adjourn.
Second.
Thank you.
All in favor? Aye. Thank you.